Good morning, church. Welcome to Light and Life Ohana. Yeehaw! Hey, we'd like to welcome you to church this morning. Praise God for this beautiful day. And we had an awesome weekend celebrating my wife's birthday. And we're going to continue to raise the roof and celebrate the Lord. Thank you, Lord, for this day. Thank you for coming into our presence. Have your way, baby. Have your way with us. Come on in. This morning, we're so pumped up. We've been waiting for the last half an hour. We were so pumped up. We was up ready early to go on, and we want to praise and thank God. Our hearts cry out to you, Lord. It is the cry of my heart to follow. Follow all of Worship you, Lord. We give praise for the assurance you give us of that promise.
Blessed assurance, Jesus is salvation.
I am weak, but thou art strong. Grant me, Jesus, keep from all wrong. I'll be satisfied as long as I walk. Let me walk close to thee. Just a closer walk with thee. Granted, Jesus is my plea. Of toil and if I falter, Lord, who cares? Who with me, my burden? Is my plea. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord, for those classics. Amen. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. E puli ka ku. E hova he molele ki a kua I ka hiko ia. I ka nani ka ihi ihi a me ka hano hano. Ke ho mai kai ke ho zana ke mililani. A ho ho aku nei mako ia oi. No laila. I aloha mai oi. I ka poikawa. I a koko mai nei. E ho mai kai ia mako. A me ka mako mauhana. A ilona. Pumai ko uhane he molele, me mako I kuliki ai ka mako lawe lawe ana, me kau I make make ai. No laila, e ho onani ia ai oi I loko o ka inoa, o ka makua, ke keiki a me ka uhane he molele. O Holy Jehovah the God, it is filled with splendor, sacredness, and glory. We thank, praise, and glorify thee this morning. Therefore have mercy upon us who are gathered together. Bless us in our work. Let your Holy Spirit abide with us, that we may be able to do thy work according to your will. Therefore, we praise thee in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. And everybody says, amen. Amen, church. How are we doing today? How you doing? Hey, do me a favor. Go around and greet each other this morning. Say hi. Let us know if this is your first time. Let us know where you're from. We'll say aloha to you all. And thanks for joining us this morning.
We're together again, just praising the Lord. We're together again in one accord. Something good is about to happen. Something good is in store.
Time, hano.
We're together again.
Good morning, cousin.
Just praising the Lord.
Oh, two cousins.
We're together again in one accord.
Let you wonder.
Something good is about to happen. Something good is in store. We're together again.
Hey, Pastor Brian.
Just praising the Lord.
Something good, Renee.
Something good is about to happen. Something good is in store. We're together again.
I act your lover.
Just praising the Lord. We're together again. Just praising the Lord. We're together again. Just praising the Lord.
Praise the Lord. Thank you, guys. Thank you, Jesus, for coming into our presence. Hallelujah. Hey, welcome once again to Light and Life Ohana Church. We're here live every Sunday morning at 8:30. And actually, we've been getting a little bit early, you know, just to keep you on your toes. So come on early. We put music out early to let you know that we're coming on soon, which about like 5 minutes here, about 5 minutes. We got some music, and then we get the opening video, and boom, right into worship. I want to praise and thank God for our worship. Hey, letting you know some of our bulletins. Every Tuesday nights, we have Bible studies. We're in the book of Ephesians. Last week, we had my cousin from Las Vegas who did the Bible studies of Ephesians chapter 1. This week, we're on chapter 2. So if you guys not doing nothing, you want to come on in and get tapped into the word of the Lord, Come on and join us. Our Zoom room is 337-083-9458. Tap that in into the Zoom room. Log into Zoom, join, and you can type in that address, and you'll come right into our room, into the waiting room, until we let you in. And as soon as it goes ding, then I'll let you in, and you come right in and join in the conversation. So join us every Tuesdays. Also, just to let you know that we are pumping them on YouTube. We've been doing it for a while, but why we just want to let people know that, hey, if you know people that don't do Facebook, you can send them this. You can email or text them this Zoom link. We usually put the Zoom on Facebook so you can find that Zoom and just copy and paste it into your text. And you can let people know who don't do Facebook, they can still watch our services. And that is, but that's not live. That's like after this, probably in the evening by the time it gets uploaded, because we got to upload the service, and it's about over an hour and a half, maybe 2 hours. I don't know. Who knows? Who knows when God speaks, right? Amen. So check it out to YouTube. We're also gonna do a short version and hopefully put that into the IG people, Instagram. So check them out. Hey, some other upcoming updates, just to like mark your calendars. November 7th, we're going to celebrate. It's not the Veterans Day, but that's that week. We usually celebrate the Sunday before the event. So November 7th, we're going to celebrate our veterans. And we also have communion on that Sunday, which is not next week. We got one more Sunday. I was reminded. We got one more Sunday. 5 Sundays this week. Wow, long month. And so join us on the 7th as we celebrate our veterans. Also, on the 21st, Thanksgiving is usually the 25th, but we're going to celebrate Thanksgiving service on the 21st because Thanksgiving usually is on Thursdays. So I don't like to do after. So we're going to celebrate our Thanksgiving on together in service on the 21st. And then December, we're hitting the month of December. We're celebrating communion. Don't forget communion every first Sundays. You guys are welcome to join us. Have your elements ready. We take communion together. And then we're going to celebrate our Christmas service on the 19th, which is the Sunday before Christmas. Wow, the end of the year already. Can you believe that? Unbelievable. I'm going to try and see if we can do some kind of socializing to celebrate Christmas. Maybe do a Christmas outing in a park where you get more people can get involved. Or, yeah, maybe caroling. We see. I'll let you guys know. All right? But in the meantime, you can mark your calendars with these 4 dates. All right? All right. All right. We're going to get right into our message. Sorry, no specials today. Because it's a long message. Just kidding. You never know. We're going to do our message. This comes from the New Testament in the book of John. John chapter 16. No Hawaiian. We're going to stick with the pigeon one more time. I'm practicing. Practicing my pigeon. So John chapter 16, verse 12 to 15. This is coming from the Hawaiian pigeon book, or what is it called? The good book or something like that. The special book. There you go. Good and special book. All right. Verse 12. I still get plenty more stuff for tell you guys. But that's more than you guys can handle right now. When the Spirit come that make you guys know that truth, he going to show you guys how to do the true stuff. He not going to talk by himself, but he going to tell you what my Father will tell him. And he going to tell you guys about the stuff that I going to happen. That going to happen, Bombay. 14. That's how you're going to show how awesome I stay. Because he going to tell, he going to take all the true stuff about me and show you guys what all that mean. Everything my father get, that's mine too. That's why I went say God's spirit going to take all the true stuff about me and show you guys what that mean. In an NIV, it reads like this, verse 12. I have much more to say to you, more than you can now bear. But when he, the Spirit of truth, comes, he will guide you into all truth. He will not speak on his own. He will speak only what he hears, and he will tell you what is yet to come. Verse 14. He will glorify me because it is from me that he will receive what he will make known to you. All that belongs to my Father is mine. This is why I said the Spirit will receive from me what he will make known to you. Let us pray. Lord, I praise and thank you for those scriptures for today. And we thank you for worship that brought us into this word that you have for us today. And Lord, bless the hearts that are here to receive your message. And may my words be your words, and my thoughts be your thoughts. But Lord, whatever is shared that it can be received, it can be taken deep into our hearts. But Lord, not just receive it, that we can utilize it and share it with the rest of the world. So we want to praise and thank you for our scripture reading this morning. And just come on in and have your way. We pray all this in your precious and in your holy name. And everybody says, amen. Well, as the French soldier dug in the desert sand, reinforcing the defenses of his army's encampment, he had no idea he would make a momentous discovery. Too much hyperbolical words. Moving another shovelful of sand, he saw a stone. Not just any stone, it was a Rosetta Stone, containing a listing of the good things King Ptolemy the Fifth had done for his priests and the people of Egypt, written in three scripts. That stone, now housed in the British Museum, would be one of the most important archaeological finds of the 19th century, helping to unlock the mysteries of the ancient Egyptian writing known as hieroglyphics. For many of us, much of scripture is also wrapped in deep mystery. Still, the night before the cross, Jesus promised his followers that he would send the Holy Spirit. He told them, but when he, the Spirit of truth, comes, he will guide you into the truth. He will not speak of his own. He will speak only what he hears, and he will tell you what is yet to come. The Holy Spirit is, in a sense, our divine Rosetta Stone, shedding the light on the truth, including truths behind the mysteries of the Bible. We're not promised absolute understanding of everything given to us in these scriptures, we can have confidence that by the Holy Spirit, we can comprehend everything necessary for us to follow Jesus. He will guide us into those vital truths. So we're going to begin our message, and in John 12 to 15 begins with Jesus telling his disciples this profound statement. He says, I still have many things to say to you, But you cannot bear them now. Yeah? And he's talking about the truth, because God only speaks the truth. Yeah? He says, I have much more to say, but you cannot handle. Yeah? Well, Jesus, he was preparing his disciples for what is about to happen. Yeah? And what was about to happen? That he was about to leave them and go back to the Father. Yeah? Jesus has been explaining the coming and the work of the Holy Spirit. In verse 5 to 7, he's been introducing the Holy Spirit, which is going to help and be with the disciples when he has to descend back to the Father. And the main reason Christ has made these comments is to prepare his disciples for the hard times that was ahead. Yeah, he was preparing them because there were some hard times that was coming up ahead of them. In fact, in the next few days, yeah, they will see him arrested, crucified. And after Jesus is resurrected, they will have to help. They will have the help of the Holy Spirit. Yeah, but they still were going to be subjected to persecution. Let me share with you a scripture. In John 14:26, it says, but the advocate of the Holy Spirit, whom the Father will send in my name, will teach you all things and will remind you of everything I have said to you. See, Jesus had taught them, you know, when he gathered them and they went walking around and sharing and you know, speaking to the 5,000, breaking the fish. This is all the on the job training that Jesus was giving his disciples, because when he was about to go back to the Father, there was to carry on the work. Right? What did he tell them before he left? He said what? Not before he descended, he told them go out and share the gospel to the end of the world. Yeah. So he was preparing them for what's about to happen, and he was introducing to them that, hey, the Holy Spirit is going to be with you folks. I'm not going to be here in person anymore. I have to go back to my Father. But the Holy Spirit will be with you and will help you, will teach you, and will remind you of all the stuff that I taught you. Yeah? He'll keep you in check, basically. And knowing these hard times were predicted gives us reassurance that God is still in control. Yeah? So the persecutions we face what? Bullying. We can face financial struggles. We face political struggles. And we're facing pandemic struggles. And it says through all of that, what is the main thing that the Holy Spirit reminds us is that God is still in control. A recurring theme in the Bible is that God understands our weaknesses. He knows all things. Jesus in particular can relate. Why? Because at one point he was introduced to human temptation. Since he walked and experienced this human life, this discussion Jesus was having with his disciples almost certainly made them nervous and afraid. Yeah? They probably was just rattled. What? You know? He kind of like came out of left field. How many of you been in that situation? Everything running smooth and all of a sudden, poof! Your life is like an opera. And Jesus was preparing them, said, hey, calm down. I'm letting you know this is going to happen, but you know what? You don't have to worry. God always gives us that reassurance that we don't have to worry, right? Because why? He's in control. He's always been and always will be in control. Despite the turmoil that's going on in your life, God is there. The question is, where are you? Yeah? Where are you in this time? And that's what Jesus was saying, that the Holy Spirit is going to be there to remind you that, hey, JJWD, what would Jesus do? Yeah, because God is real. He's there for you. We need to tap into being remembered that God will never forsake us or abandon us in times of need. And rather than overwhelm them, the disciples, with even more stuff to teach them, Jesus knows when to stop. Yeah? And so Jesus prepares them by telling them, you know what? There's more for you guys to learn, but I'm not going to be here. So the Spirit, the Holy Spirit will take over. He will be my advocate. Now, what is an advocate? Someone who speaks on behalf. So the Holy Spirit speaks on behalf of Jesus, on behalf of the Father. And this, again, is one of the reasons God will send the Holy Spirit. He will send the Holy Spirit to teach, encourage, and remind the disciples of the things that they can't yet fully understand. Yeah? And that's why he says, in our scripture, that I get many more things to tell you, but you no can bear it now because you can't understand it. You won't be able to comprehend it yet because your mind is not where it needs to be yet to understand it. Let us move on to our next verse. In verse 13, he says, but when he or the Spirit of truth comes, he will guide you into all the truth. And he will speak on, not on his own, but he will speak only what he hears, and he will tell you what is yet to come. He will speak only what he hears. It means he's going to be speaking, advocating on behalf of the Father, the King. Yeah? God. He's going to speak on behalf of God to let you know what's coming up, what's about to come, and to prepare you guys selves. Yeah? Jesus refers to the Helper or the Holy Spirit as the Spirit of truth. And he tells them that the Spirit of truth will come in place of him. Once again, he's telling them, I'm not going to be here. But the Spirit of truth, or the Holy Spirit, will be the one to advocate and teach you folks, teach you guys, encourage you guys, to remind you of all the teachings that I've taught you. And Jesus says, he will help you while I'm gone. The Holy Spirit will help guide them. He will be there to teach them all the rest. And because they weren't ready to comprehend all of it, the Holy Spirit was given to them. And the Holy Spirit is still here. That's why when we are baptized and we come up new, the Lord knows that we didn't be able to walk with Jesus because he's not here, but he gave us the Holy Spirit. And when you rose, you was also anointed with the Holy Spirit. Even despite they were still in disbelief what was about to happen. You know that? How many of us are that? We cannot believe what? Pandemic. I mean, some of us still today. We cannot believe what's going on. And what? I got to still wear my mask. What? I cannot go here. What? I need one card for getting to go eat. Yeah, we still cannot believe what's happening. We still cannot comprehend. And God is sending his Holy Spirit to descend upon us today to say, hey, relax. No worry, beef curry. You guys ever try calling zippies? Yeah? And you find out the menu. Every time you get curb beef curry. That's what the guy says. Hey, no worry, beef curry. That's what we're having today. And Jesus telling us today, hey, no worry, beef curry. Why? Because God is still in control. And he gives us the wisdom through the Holy Spirit to handle things of this world. Yeah? He gives us, and we need to seek God constantly so that we understand and we can remember and be uplifted and to help uplift others that, hey, relax. You know, somebody having a panic attack, hey, no worry, relax. God is, God loves you. God is in control. Just calm down. It's okay. You don't have to worry. Tomorrow's not promised. Enjoy what God has placed in front of you today. And he not just said that the Holy Spirit going to help you. He says the Holy Spirit will help you to the end. What does that mean? He will help you to the end. It means he's going to help you until the Lord comes back to take us home. Well, how can he help us? Well, the Holy Spirit, when I looked it up, the Holy Spirit had these seven gifts. And the seven gifts is wisdom. He's going to help teach us wisdom, understanding, counsel, fortitude, knowledge, piety, and the fear of the Lord. There are so many ways that the Holy Spirit works in our lives. But they all share just one common goal. And what is that common goal? It's to make us more like Christ. The Holy Spirit is a major part of our spiritual growth. We definitely cannot accomplish things on our own. But it's the Spirit that leads us towards what's best for us. He leads us to what's best for us, always in his way and always in his timing. Let me share with you a scripture in 1 Corinthians chapter 6. I'm going to read verse 19 and 20. It says, do you not know that your bodies are temples of the Holy Spirit, who is in you, whom you have received from God? You are not your own. Verse 20, you are bought with a price. Therefore, honor God with your bodies. How do we know that the Holy Spirit is within us? If we can live a life that has the presence of the fruit of the Spirit. Oh, what is the fruit of the Spirit? Well, in your life, we share love, joy, peace, long-suffering, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. Underline down. That one is kind of hard, yeah? Self-control. See, growth takes time, and you can be patient as you grow in the Spirit, as you grow in the fruit of the Spirit. See, the Holy Spirit is there to help teach us all of this. It helps to remind us about loving our neighbors. It helps to encourage us and lift us up that we can find joy. The joy of the Lord is my strength. We need joy because the joy is our strength to overcome the craziness of this world. The Holy Spirit helps to give us peace and say, hey, brother, hey, sister, chill out. Don't get nuts. Don't come carrying it out. Don't be a carrying. relax. It's okay. Somebody like the space, give them the space. Because why? Jesus is going to give us the special Jesus space. Yeah, right in front. So why fight over one star that's like two blocks away? Take it easy. You know? Why stress out in traffic? Yeah, and you're trying to zoom in, you know the zoomies. Zoom in, zoom out. Call them zoomies. Yeah, they're the ones causing more traffic. But why panic? Why go nuts about it? Hey, relax. Getting nuts not going to get you any faster, closer. If you would relax. Yesterday I was like, oh, traffic. But you know what? I said, you know what, God, you're going to take care. You know, because had traffic westbound. I don't know if you guys heard about it. Was all it backed up. When I was driving to Salt Lake, was like, oh, by Waikele, I think, almost. And I was like, that's okay. I get time. Just have the joy of the Lord in my heart. Pick up my stuff. I went there. Whole. And you know what? It's just amazing. I was kind of unbelievably racked. My wife would have been very proud of me. I was so relaxed. Got there crowded like knots in the pickup side. Only had like one stall left all the way inside. So, I just didn't drive in. I sat there relaxed in my AC car and waited till the lady came. But, you know, I think she already knew because, you know, you put down what stall you in. So she bought my stuff already. Gave her my code. Gave me stuff. Hey, not even 2 minutes. I was out of there. And that place was packed. I was tripping. On the way back home, you know, I was just peace and calm. And, man, I made it home pretty fast despite the traffic. The traffic when calmed down by then was past Cunha. Not past Cunha, but I got past Cunha before I got stopped in a little bit of traffic. All I did was just move into one lane that just kept flowing. And then came to my cutoff, went over, and boom, I was home in no time. So, you know, and that's the Holy Spirit calms us down, yeah? It teaches us so much of these good attributes that helps our spiritual growth through the fruits of the Spirit. Let me share with you one more scripture in Galatians. Galatians chapter 5. I'm going to read 22 and 23. It says that, but the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, forbearance, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. Against such things there is no law. That's the fruit of the Spirit. That's what the Holy Spirit comes to help us, to teach us that we can grow. Once we can have this fruit of the Spirit within our lives, we can start to walk more like Jesus did. Right? And that's the goal. The ultimate goal is to walk in the footsteps of the Lord. It's not about doing good deeds. And it's not about, you know, I mean, it is. But if we can concentrate and focus more on the fruit of the Spirit, we don't have to worry about, yeah, we don't have to worry about sinning. If you have these fruit of the Spirit in your life, you don't have to worry too much about sinning. Because we're starting to transform to be walking more like Jesus did than our old self. Because that last part that we're underlining is what? Self-control. What is self-control? WWJD. That's what self-control is. Anytime something comes up, WWJD. Ah, that's like your pill. You know when you get gout, you take one pill. That's your pill. WWJD. Prevents you from sinning. And the Holy Spirit is the advocate that gives us the tools that we need, which is the fruit of the Spirit. It gives us love, joy, peace, forbearance, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, self-control. You no more time for sin. right? You don't want time for sin because we're focusing on what Jesus did. That's what we should apply to our lives. Stuff going wrong at work? Whoa, pray to God. Lord, help me, Lord. Yeah, help me. And the Holy Spirit descends upon you and it points out what you need to know. And it points out in the direction you should go. But it still gives us the choice. It still gives us a choice. Choose God or choose your own way. You know, like how you get the angel on one side, the devil on one side. That's the choice. You can either listen to the angel or you can listen to the devil. Choose joy. The joy of the Lord is your strength. All right, let us get to the next verse, 14. It says, He will glorify me because it is from me that he will receive what he will make known to you. Christ is reassuring his closest disciples that when he leaves, the physical absence will allow the work of the Holy Spirit. And that's why he's about to introduce the Holy Spirit, because he's about to leave. And the Holy Spirit up until that time, they never know who he was or what he does. It's because they never need, because Jesus was there with them. But now that his physical absence is going to allow now the Holy Spirit to take over as an advocate. See, part of the Spirit's ministry is to convict the world so that non-believers will become confronted with the realities of sin, righteousness, and judgment. In the lives of believers, the primary work of the Holy Spirit is to guide and direct us in the truth. Let me say that again. The Holy Spirit helps. Its primary work is to help us and guide us and direct us towards the truth, or towards the light, towards God. Let me share with you a scripture in John. John chapter 8. I'm going to read 31 and 32. It says, To the Jews who had believed him, Jesus said, If you hold to my teachings, you are really my disciples. And in 32 he says, Then you will know the truth, and the truth will set you free. Hallelujah. See, the work of the Holy Spirit glorifies Christ, which means it glorifies God. And in John 1:1-2, it says that in the beginning was the Word. The Word was with God. The Word was God. He was with God in the beginning. And in chapter 1, verse 1 and 2, it establishes that the Word in the Bible, the words in the Bible is of God. And then in verse 14, John establishes that the Word as Jesus. Let me share that verse, John 1:14. It says that the Word became flesh and made his dwelling among us. That's God sending his Son. The Word was God. And he sent his Son to dwell among this world. It became flesh. We have seen his glory, the glory of the one and only Son, who came from the Father, full of grace and truth. And that his name was Jesus. His name was Jesus. And at the start of the Gospel of John, Jesus' ministry is described by saying the Word became flesh, dwelt among us, and we have seen his glory, the glory of the only Son from the Father. What we see is in Christ is a representation of God the Father. And what we see in the Holy Spirit is a representation of Jesus, and who is the representation of the Father. You see, that's how I think this is where the Trinity comes in. See, when the Holy Spirit teaches us truth, it is speaking of Jesus, just as it was speaking of God the Father. Yeah? And that's why, you know, if you like even in our prayer at the end, is that the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Being that Jesus is about to ascend to heaven to be with the Father, he tells his disciple that the Spirit will descend upon them to help them carry out their work. See, God sits on the throne right now. And Jesus, when he descended when he ascended up to the Father, he sits right on the right hand side of the Father. Hence, the Holy Spirit descended upon his disciples, upon us. When we become believers, when we are baptized, the Holy Spirit, we're anointed with the Holy Spirit. The power of the Lord is within us. If you are a believer, the power of the Lord is within us through the Holy Spirit. And as we let the Holy Spirit live within us, the Holy Spirit, through the fruits of the Spirit, helps to teach us to be more like Jesus. Our last verse, verse 15, it says, "All that belongs to the Father is mine. That is why I said the Spirit will receive from me what he will make known to you." As Jesus prepares for his impending arrest and execution, he reassures the disciples by predicting the coming of the Holy Spirit. Much of Jesus he has said was not understood by his disciples. Only after his resurrection and with the empowerment of the Spirit will they be able to fully grasp all that's happening. See, they couldn't believe when Jesus was preparing them, when Jesus was telling them, when they was in the upper room during the Last Supper, and Jesus telling them, and Peter, right? Oh no, Jesus, I'll be right there by you all the way to the end. I won't, you know. And Jesus said to them, Peter, before the rooster crow, before the rooster crow, you would have denied me three times. Yeah. Doubting Thomas. Called him up by the name, man. And Judas. In this statement, Jesus once again asserts that he is divine. Likewise, he refers to the Holy Spirit in tying together all three members of the Trinity. John began his gospel explaining that Jesus present on earth graciously presented the truth of God. And the guidance of the Holy Spirit will always lead a person towards or into the truth. That does not mean every claim of inspiration is true. Born-again Christians can be sincerely wrong at times. Yeah. Sometimes we start out good, but then we lose the focus when we take our eyes off of the Lord. When we start bringing in our thoughts into this instead of following his footsteps. Sometimes we get ahead of him. And then we get a little bit cocky and we say, oh, Lord, no worry, I get him. Take a break. How sad is that, yeah? Other spiritual voices can lead us astray. False prophets. Or anyone who teaches what's not in the Bible, what's not true. Some have their own Bibles or their own doctrines. What is the truth is only in the Bible. How can we tell? Because whatever is in the Bible that's printed in the Bible comes true. Predicted him, Jesus being born. Predicted that he was crucified by his own. Predicted that he would rise in 3 days and ascend back to the Father. Predicted sending the Holy Spirit. Everything that's in the Bible, it will come to pass. That's why a lot of the scholars believe that we're getting close to the end of the world. Because we already tapping into what? Revelations. What you see is going down in the world today, the destruction, the, what is that? The world, the environment of the world. Yeah. Everybody noticing sun getting a little hotter. The climate is just kind of like not normal. Yeah. Summer coming early, winter coming later. Yeah. We notice all of the hurricanes getting worse, earthquakes, the volcano erupted. Yeah. Look the kind. I don't know. Everybody felt the earthquake the other day. And Mother Nature acting up again on Big Island. Around the world, buildings falling because of the world destruction. The climate. Yeah, how many buildings in foreign countries just collapsing because of earthquakes or whatever? It's all coming to pass. If you read, even like locusts, birds. Thousands of birds overtaking one house. That's all written in the Bibles. These stuff will happen. The signs of the coming. Let us be vigilant. Let us be aware of what's going on in this world. Discipleship and the written word are crucial in the process of following God. Let me share with you one more scripture here. Matthew 28:19-20. Therefore go, this is what Jesus tells his disciples. He says, therefore go, make disciples of all the nations, and baptizing them in the name of the Trinity again, the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. And he continues by saying, and teaching them to obey everything I have commanded you. And surely, this is what I like. This is my favorite part about the scripture, that he always ends with this. of reassurance, of promise. And surely I am with you always. And it's not even enough. He says to the very end of age. Talk about an encouragement statement right there. And surely I am with you always to the very end of age. Awesome. Awesome statement by our Father. And however, the voice of the Spirit provides insight which is simply unavailable to those who are not believers. See, the scriptures is for everybody and anybody who wants to believe that God is who he says he is. And non-believers, it's useless because they don't believe. A lot of times they wait till too late. You know what happened with Noah, right? He told them, God told him that it's going to rain. And so he built this big ark, whoever wanted to be saved. And he told them, and people were just laughing, mocking him. Until what? He shut the door and started to drizzle and started to rain. And people was like running to the hills, pounding on their... You imagine how much faith that Noah had when God told him, "Hey, I like you build an ark out of these woods. Big. I like you build one big enough to house all the animals, two of each, and whoever like jumping on a boat." But you know what? When you build a boat, most of the time you can figure you're going to build a boat closer to the water. No, I like you build them over there on the top of the mountain. How many of you would had enough faith to do that, man? I think he had the most awesomest faith to do. I mean, I'm pretty sure even his kids and maybe even his wife was like, "Are you nuts? Are you kidding me?" But that's what happens when we follow and listen to the Father. And God sends his Holy Spirit to let us know, to teach us and to lead us in that direction. That, and it's just a matter of us choosing to follow the angel or the devil that's sitting on your shoulders. If I was you, I would flick that devil off. And just keep the angel. Let me share with you one last scripture. In 1 Corinthians 2. And I'm going to read 14 to 16. It says that the person with the Spirit does not accept the things that come from the Spirit. I'm sorry. Let me repeat that again. The person without the Spirit does not accept the things that come from the Spirit of God. But considers them foolishness. And cannot understand them because they are discerned only through the Spirit. But the person with the Spirit makes judgments about all things. But such a person is not subject to merely human judgments. For who has known the mind of the Lord so as to instruct him? But we have the mind of Christ. See, before Jesus left the earth, he promised his disciples that he would send the Spirit of truth, who would guide them into all the truth. And the Spirit would rely what Jesus made known to him. Jesus also told them that when they were arrested and brought to trial, they needed not to worry beforehand about what to say. Instead, they were to speak whatever was given to them to say, because it would be the Holy Spirit speaking through them. And in Luke, Jesus says something similar. He says, when you are brought before authorities, do not worry about how you will defend yourself or what you will say, for the Holy Spirit will teach you at that time what you should say. In a season of persecution, the Holy Spirit will help and equip all who believe in Christ and our Father in heaven. Well, let me end this message by a story. And this story is entitled From False to the Truth by Osho. O-S-H, Osho. Yeah. I think, yeah. Osho. So, O-S-H-O anyway. From False to Truth by Osho. Well, one day I was playing. I must have been 5 or 6 years old. A man used to come to see my father, an utterly boring man. And my father was growing tired of him. So he called me and told me, I see that man is coming. He will waste my time unnecessarily, and it is very difficult to get rid of him. Oh, this sounds familiar. How many of you guys said this? I always have to go out and say to him, now I have some appointment. Unnecessarily, I have to go out just to get rid of him. And sometimes it happens that he says, hey, I'll come with you. So on the way, we can have a good talk. And there is no talk. It's just a monologue. He talks and tortures people. So my father said, I'm going inside. You just remain playing outside. And when you see him come, just simply tell him, hey, my father, he went out. He's not home. Know what he said? No. Just simply say to him that your father's out. And my father used to teach me continuously, never speak untruth. Always speak the truth. So I was kind of shocked. This was kind of not contradictory, right? So when the man came and asked me, where's your father? I said, well, he is in, but he says that he is out. My father heard this from inside, and the man entered with me so he could not say anything in front of him. When the man had gone, after 2 or 3 hours, my father was really angry with me, not at the man. He said, I told you to tell him my father is out. I said, exactly. I repeated the same thing. I told him the same thing. My father says to tell you that he is out, but he is in. The truth is, he is in. You have been teaching me to be true, whatever the consequences. So I am ready for the consequence. Any punishment, if you want to give me, give me. But remember, if truth is punishment, truth is destroyed. Truth has to be rewarded. Give me some reward so I can go on speaking the truth, whatever happens. He looked at me and he said, you are clever. I said, that you know already, just give me some reward. I have spoken the truth. And he had to give me some reward.
Let us pray.
Lord, I praise and thank you for the scripture reading. I thank you for the words of wisdom that you have shared with us. And I thank you for the story that we should speak the truth and learn from the truth, because the truth shall set us free. Lord, I thank you so much for your Holy Spirit that lives within us. I thank you that you have descended the Holy Spirit to be anointed upon us, that he can live through us and we can teach us and we can grow to walk in your Son's footsteps. So we want to praise and thank you this morning for our worship. We want to thank you for the Holy Spirit, the Spirit of truth, that will teach us to be truthful and seek the truth, because the truth sets us free. And Lord, I always thank you so much for that promise and backing up your scripture with an uplifting remark that you will be with us to the end. You'll never forsaken us or leave us, but you will be with us to the end. Bless the hearts that have received us this morning, and that they can take what they received today and share that amongst those that they meet and they come across in their lives. That they can have the Holy Spirit, that they can start walking more and more like you every day. Thank you, Lord. We pray this in your precious and your holy name. Amen.
Take my life, a living sacrifice. Knowing it's the least that I can do. Make my life a living sacrifice. Holy and acceptable to you. I looked upon my life, realized alive, within myself there's nothing I can do. Yet here I stand to offer all I am and give myself. Sacrifice.
Praise God. Thank you guys for joining us this morning, anointing. Hey, you guys, hope you folks have a great, great week. We got one more Sunday this month, and man, it's November. That's the most best month, November. Yeah, honey. Anyway, we're getting close to the end of this year already. I can't believe this year has just flown right by. But I want to praise and thank God for this day. We want to thank you for this this morning's worship, for the word. I just want to thank you guys for joining us. Do me a favor. Put joy in your life. Let joy or the joy of the Lord strengthen your lives, and you can just overcome the sins of this world by just being happy, man. So do us a favor. Share that smile with someone you meet. Yeah. Share that smile so they can see the light that draws them to the Father in heaven. I want to praise and thank you guys. You guys have a blessed day. Awesome Sunday. And we see you folks next week. Bye. Hey, I don't know what we get, but we're going to have something Saturday at Ohana to sell. Hopefully, we're going to have the kind of, what is that? Rice Krispie thing? Energy bar. And we're probably going to be soon to make some Christmas cookies. Hey, but anyway, if you guys love that Ohia bakery cookies, shortbread and shortbread chocolate chip, there's only a few left. Less than, probably by now, because the way Tiny has been selling it, only have maybe a dozen left, if we're lucky. If you want, go get them now. It's prices for go. What is that? Oh, only get 14 bags, and he's what, selling them for three for $10. So went from $7 a bag. The last 14 is going three for $10. Yeah? For a good cause to help our ministry to grow. And I want to say mahalo for Brother Tiny for always helping us in our ministry center. And I want to thank God that, and actually want to thank Mr. Chris Ulu and the Ohana Hale Marketplace staff, as well as the vendors. It's been an awesome experience and growing and just sharing the word of God. I mean, giving away Bibles. We've been getting a lot of prayer requests. So God is good all the time. You guys have a blessed day, and we'll see you guys next week. Let us close our service by our benediction. Imao mai ke loho o Yehova ke akua, kama makua aloha oe o ko mako haku, aloha o Yesu Christo, a meka launa aloha olo olo ana mai, o ko o hanehe mulele, me ka ko. May the blessings of Jehovah God, the Father of our Lord of love, Jesus Christ, and the love of the Holy Spirit abide with us all, now and forevermore. And everybody says, amen. My God is sufficient. He knows every problem. He knows just how much I can bear. Every stumble, every falter, keep your eye upon the other. My God is sufficient for me. My God. How much I can bear. Every problem, every falter, keep your eyes. Have a great day in the Lord. Aloha. Okay then. Bye-bye. Sayonara. Kansamina. Okay. Aloha. She. What else? Talofa. Mabuhay.
Every nation, every tongue, lift up your voice, sing a brand new song. Sing of his love and all that he has done. From generation to generation, he's been so faithful and his love never changes, no. I'm gonna testify, lift my hands and pray. He's been so faithful.